Yes. In honor of having Chef and Pitmaster Kevin Bledsoe here, we're going to take a little deeper look at barbecue sauce with our very own Dan Kohler. How are you, sir?
I'm terrific. And truly, this is in honor of you because I can't top what you did out there.
He's going to be the judge. No pressure.
None at all.
Okay, I want to talk about barbecue sauce.
Let's talk.
As a guy who's been at Food Network for about 16, 17 years, there's sauces in Kansas City, in St. Louis, in North Carolina, in South Carolina, in Texas, and they're all different. They're all great. But the differentiation is insane.
Well, it's insane. And the interesting thing about barbecue sauce that I will say is that it's international in its origins. But as you said, I would say it's uniquely American in its maturity. So every state, every region has their own. And it's because of how barbecue was developed. So if we look at just speaking of the meat first, if we look at how that technique of cooking came to be, we look at Christopher Columbus visiting Hispaniola, which we now know as Haiti in the Dominican Republic. When he travels there, he finds the Taino Indians, and they're doing something called babraco. And babraco,
that's where the word comes from.
Babraco is actually a method of cooking meat slowly over green wood, which produces a ton of smoke, which I think you would know is the secret ingredient.
That's right.
Smoke is what's making all this magical. So when they move up to North America, that's where we get this idea of smoking meat, because in Europe, that was not used at all. So the Spanish take the word babraco and they call it barbacoa. And that, then, in America, turns into...
Oh, I know.
Barbecue. I know, barbecue.
But where did the sauce part
come
into it?
So sauce is where things get really interesting and regional. I'm going to look at three major ones here. We're going to talk about North Carolina, South Carolina, and then finally, Memphis, Tennessee. So let's start with North Carolina. Who knows the first settlement in America?
Roanoke, Virginia.
It's not Roanoke, Virginia, though. See, this is where you're wrong, Debbie.
Oh.
You see, the Roanoke colony was actually in modern day North Carolina.
Well, it's Virginia today.
So you're sort of right. Yeah.
So you see, the English settlers are coming across. We've got a map of this. They come all the way from England to Roanoke, which is technically in North Carolina. And what they're bringing with them are their tastes from home. So in England, there was a tradition of basting meats with the sauce that had just dripped off, right? But they added vinegar. Please try the first sauce on your left. This is the thinnest sauce. This is the North Carolina sauce. The North Carolina sauce comes from this taste of Britain, right? So what they want is a very spicy, acidic, astringent sauce. It's very thin. It cuts through a lot of fatty meats. And what they're doing when they get to America, they mix that vinegar with the local peppers.
So you find I like that.
You like that?
That's my favorite one.
It's almost like what goes on fish and chips.
Indeed. Yeah. It's that same idea of cutting meats with a really astringent tart sauce.
Kevin, opinion.
Like you said, it tastes like fish.
Not a fan.
I'm not a fan.
All right, North Carolina, you're on alert. Kev's not into it.
I gotta go to it. It's good.
He's more to get you. Don't worry.
He's biased. So now, if we move just across the border down to South Carolina, you'd think, well, it's not that far away, so it can't be that different. It's worlds apart. If you look at this map right now, the immigration pattern to South Carolina actually comes from Germany and Switzerland, and that's because in 1730, the governor of South Carolina actually issued a statement saying, we need more settlers. And so he paid for passage for German settlers to come all the way across the ocean and stay in South Carolina. And what they brought with them actually were their flavors from home, which was what we found with the English already.
Yes.
But the flavors from Germany and Switzerland in this case are mustard and honey, a little bit of brown sugar. So that's the second sauce you've got right there in the middle.
Let's try that one.
It's a little yellower. It's completely different.
It's really good.
You like this
Delicious.
One? So far, you like this is beating, this beats North Carolina for you.
In my opinion, I agree.
All right, Kev?
That's good, man. I'd like to have it on a pulled pork sandwich.
Okay, really all right, good. All right.
That's good though, babe. I like that.
Now we're gonna talk about what I would say is the most classic sauce here, which is what we know of as barbecue sauce, this Memphis, Tennessee barbecue sauce, this deep red. The interesting map here actually is not from Europe to America. It's actually coming from the south. So Memphis, Tennessee is right on the Mississippi River, which means that it's a port city. It's got a ton of access to ingredients from all over the world. So for the first time, we have molasses and tomatoes brown sugar and mustard and vinegar all coming together to make that third sauce on your plate,
that
deep smoky red.
Interesting.
Was that closer to you, Kevin?
Yeah, that is. Everything he said.
So I'm going to show you how to make this one at home because it's my favorite. And truth be told, it couldn't be easier. This is one of those things that once you see how it's made at home, you're going to stop buying it all the time.
Mm. All right, so how do we make it?
I've got some onions and garlic that are just sweating over here. And to that, I'm adding some black pepper, some cayenne pepper, and some cumin.
That's what that is. It's cumin, I taste.
And a little bit of salt. Once we get those sizzling, We're going to add in some yellow mustard.
So you're going with straight middle of the road.
Straight middle of the road yellow mustard,
and then spice.
Exactly, exactly. Because we're going to add to that some tomato paste, and then here really, this is the unique sauce, the unique ingredient that makes Memphis barbecue sauce. Memphis barbecue sauce. Yeah. It's that molasses flavor. Yeah. So we cook that molasses into it.
Now, can I use dry mustard in that too?
You absolutely can. I would bump it up a little more if you're going to use some dry mustard.
Let me ask you why, when you go to the grocery store, there are so many aisles full. A barbecue sauce. And they've gotten out of control with ghost peppers and all sorts of insane things. It is.
Listen, there are you know, chili heads all across the country because they're thrill seekers, right? There's people who want to taste this spice from every part of the world. Right. Now, when you're making barbecue sauce, all you want to do is mix all this together, and you want to cook it down until it's nice and dark, which you can see is basically already happening. Once it starts to bubble like that, we're going to add some apple cider vinegar. Mm. Bring in that classic British flavor right there.
Right. Mm-hmm.
A little bit of tomato puree.
Yeah.
And
Tabasco sauce.
Mm. You know,
pick it up a notch.
Just a few kicks. Just a few kicks. And this is where you can really make sauce all your own, right?
You know what's so great about this? The truth of the matter is, you know what is in it. You know every single ingredient. You can pronounce every single ingredient. It came from God's green earth. It's like, what were we saying earlier?
Yeah,
gum?
Where's the guar gum?
Guar gum. I missed that flavor. Where's the guar gum in there?
Now, I will say, and this is a question actually you asked me earlier, you know, there are no preservatives in this. This is a really natural sauce. So this is the sort of thing you want to use up in 3 weeks to a month in your refrigerator.
Okay.
And I've got that swap right over here. Once it cooks down about 20, 30 minutes, you've got this beautiful bubbling vat of barbecue sauce that you can use on everything from chicken to ribs to hot to sausage, right? That's the holy trinity of a Texas barbecue
there. Some good pork sausage.
You can put it on toast.
It works.
I know, it's good on toast. Look at that.
Do you talk to yourself all the time? Because everything you say is just so fascinating. Like, is it shopping with you always such a struggle?
Shopping with me is
I bet.
For more from Dan and the full recipe, you can visit RenegadeKitchen.com. Coming up next, Shirley and her new outfit.
Yes. Thank you, Lawrence. And I have the recipe for a beautiful porch planter. It's going to be easy.